From our collection of propaganda materials.
At this time, brothers and sisters, it is indeed my pleasure to introduce to you a brother who's been around for a long, long, long time.
Mr. Blair, this is for Iraq. Keir Starmer, this is for Gaza.
I've always...
We mustn't make the same mistake again. I'm sorry, Mr. Dyer.
You said we. Are you an Israeli?
I am, yes.
I don't debate with Israelis. I've been misled. Sorry.
What? Racism? What? Racism?
I don't recognize Israel, and I don't debate with Israelis.
I'm not the kind of man who's easily intimidated. I'm not intimidated by hostile journalists and broadcasters. I'm not intimidated by cameras being pointed in my face. I'm afraid only of God, you see. I'm afraid only of God.
Mr. Galloway, are you proud of having got rid of one of the very few black women in Parliament?
What a preposterous question. I know it's very late in the night, but wouldn't you be better by... starting by congratulating me for one of the most sensational election results in modern history.
Are you proud of having got rid of one of the very few black women in Parliament?
I'm not, Jeremy, move on to your next question.
Well, you're not answering that one.
No, because I don't believe that people get elected because of the colour of their skin. I believe people get elected because of their record and because of their policies. So move on to your next question.
Are you
because
proud?
Because I've got a lot of people who want to speak to me. If you ask that question again, I'm going. I warn you now.
Don't try and threaten me, Mr. Galloway, please.
You're the one who's trying to badger me.
I'm not trying to badger you. I'm merely asking whether you're proud of having driven out of Parliament one of the very few black women there, a woman you accused of having on her conscience the deaths of 100,000 people.
Oh, well, there's no doubt about that one.
I hope you didn't practice that question, did you? You fool. What are you? Are you a student journalist?
Tell us how much you care about Russia.
Are you a student journalist?
No, it's ITV Granada. Please,
the people just elected me.
To address some of the specifics that the Prime Minister said about you this evening, he said that you backed Hezbollah. Is that true?
I don't know what that means, backed Hezbollah. I oppose Israel's occupation of Lebanon, and I respect the right of people in occupied territory to resist their occupier. So, I'm not sure what business that is of his, because you see, they...
Hezbollah are a terrorist organization.
Actually, and they're part of the government of Lebanon, a country with which we have sovereign diplomatic relations. I had this debate with Sky's Anna Botting in 2006. It's quite an epic clip, you should watch it.
How do you justify your support for Hezbollah and its leader, Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah?
What a preposterous way to introduce an item, and what a preposterous first question. 24 years ago, on the day my daughter was born, and I've just celebrated her 24th birthday, I had to dash to the maternity hospital to see her given birth from a mass demonstration in London against the Israeli invasion and occupation of Lebanon. Israel has been invading and occupying Lebanon all of my 24-year-old daughter's life. The Hezbollah are a part of the Lebanese national resistance who are trying to drive, having successfully driven most Israelis from their land in 2000, Israel from the rest of their land, and to get back those thousands of Lebanese prisoners who were kidnapped by Israel under the terms of their illegal occupation of Lebanon. It's Israel that's invading Lebanon. It's Israel that's attacking Lebanon, not Lebanon that's attacking Israel. Israel is invading Lebanon and has killed 30 times more Lebanese civilians than have died in Israel. So it's you who should be justifying the evident bias which is written on every line on your face and is in every nuance of your voice, and is loaded in every question that you ask.
Absurd. So you would prefer Iraq still to have
Saddam
Hussein?
That's not what I said.
No, well, that's the right question, isn't it? It's a simple question, yes or no.
That's not the choice, you see. That's not the choice. That's not the choice. The idea that Iraq is better off because of what Bush and Blair did is simply absurd. You only have to look at your own news broadcasts to see how stupid a statement that is.
It's not a statement, it's a question. It's a reasonable question, and it's one that we listen.
It's
one we put to Robert
Fitz.
You're
the last people asking it. Nobody else in the world is asking it. Everybody knows this war is a bloody disaster. Why don't you just accept it? Because your station, though admittedly not as bad as the BBC, was an essential component of this invasion. You regurgitated endlessly the propaganda. I've got the videos if you want me to show you them. Endlessly regurgitated the propaganda and talked the country into its worst disaster for 100 years. So have some humility and accept that you were wrong.
It's not a question of humility, Mr. Galloway, it's a question of simply asking simple questions. And I think most of our viewers would have appreciated a straightforward yes or no. Thank you very much indeed for your time. Interesting as ever talking to you. George Galloway in central London. Thank you.
My wife's having a baby and I'm fighting a crucial by-election all on the same day. I woke up this morning to learn that Donald Trump had landed 59 cruise missiles on yet another Arab country. What could go wrong?
George Galloway is one of quite a few people today saying Ken Livingstone talked about the facts. Why do you believe it was anti-Semitic?
Well, George expressed it, as ever, far better than Ken Livingstone. George said Zionism and Nazism are two sides of the same coin. Now, that is clearly not true. Nazism was intended to destroy the Jewish people. That was his intention. The problem is that people use anti-Zionism to conceal their anti-Semitism. You say you're anti-Zionist, well, what you're really saying is you're against the existence of the State of Israel. If you don't want Israel to exist, that is clearly anti-Semitic. It's not a kind of vaguely nice opinion. It's actually a very bad opinion.
George Galloway?
No, Zionism and Israel are political constructs. If you were for the downfall of the Soviet Union, John was, that didn't mean you hated Russian people. In fact, you could say it meant the opposite, that you wanted to liberate the Russian people from the political system under which they lived. Ken Livingstone doesn't have a racist bone in his body. In fact, he'd still be the mayor of London if he hadn't gone out on a limb on anti-racist causes over and over again. We cannot allow this conflation. It's dangerous for everybody. Being against Israel is not being against Jews. Many Jews are against Israel. You've just had one on the screen, Lenny Brannan.
He's probably the greatest populist, apart from Ken Livingstone, that the left of the Labour Party has produced, and I expect him to bring some drama back into the Parliament.
There are people that listen to what you say, what you say about whether or not Israel has a right to exist, what you say about what many Jewish people think are threatening slogans.
We had this conversation last night. Why are you reheating it?
Because in the light of the Prime Minister's statement...
Don't keep
statement.
Telling me about the Prime Minister as if he was Moses.
Do you not respect the Prime Minister?
Do I respect the Prime Minister? I despise the Prime Minister. And guess what? Guess what? Millions and millions and millions of people in this country despise the Prime Minister. I don't respect the Prime Minister at all.
Right, you put your finger on the button, though, didn't you, when you said that Hezbollah was set up back in the 1980s in order to remove every Israeli soldier from Lebanese soil. As you said, it achieved that in 2000.
No, it didn't.
This is a setback.
No, it didn't. This is a key point that you're concealing from your viewers. Israel was forced out of most of the south of Lebanon in 2000. It still occupies a part of Lebanon. Since 2000,
the Sheba Farms area was just subject to this latest UN draft resolution.
Thousands of Lebanese prisoners have been kidnapped by Israel. Hezbollah.
I spoke just a moment ago to the Israeli Foreign Ministry spokesman, who said that the three Lebanese who have been captured, perhaps you'd like to use that word, have been before a judge and been through a court of law.
Oh, please, have a slightly longer memory than 4 weeks. I'm talking about the thousands of prisoners taken during the 18 years of Israeli occupation, illegal occupation of South Lebanon. These are the prisoners that have to be released in exchange for the Israeli soldiers that were captured at the beginning of this wave of the crisis.
Oh, wait, I mean, John McTernan quoted you actually earlier. I mean, you know, you had said Nazism and Zionism were two sides of the same coin.
Well, they actually did mint a coin use in the program, the Havara program.
For the deal.
To ship Jews out of Germany. Here's the point.
But do you think that some people might take offense to that?
No, Zionism and Nazism, for a brief period of time, cooperated to get Jews out of Germany because both of them believed that Jews should not be in Germany. The Zionists believed they should be in Palestine for one set of reasons, and the Nazis believed
it. But to say Hitler supported Zionism is surely a perversion. Zionism was about liberating Jews from persecution.
It's not, look, the Zionists were not Nazis and the Nazis were not Zionists. And actually, if you look at the transcript, Livingston never said that they were. He said that they cooperated together, and they did. That's a matter of historical fact.
He said Hitler supported Zionism.
You don't actually need to bring the historian from America. You could bring many historians from Israel. This is not a secret. It's only a secret to those now waking up to it. They were cooperating because they had the same idea that the European Jews should not be in Europe. They should be in Palestine.
Now what?
And you will not trick me or force me into retreating from the platform on which I stood and for which I now have a mandate that I will take into the House of Commons on Monday. I'm not Jeremy Corbyn, you see. I don't turn the other cheek. If you slap me, I'll slap you back.
Gorgeous George Galloway, an MP, described himself as a bit of a catch.
George's a street fighter as a politician. He's a great orator.
It was an incredible speech, and it actually captivated the House. He's capable of doing this extraordinary speech. But
we congratulate the Honourable Gentleman on his stunning by-election victory and his return to this House of Commons. And I know he always speaks with great power and great force.
You know, I always ask politicians, if somebody's speaking, who would you go in to listen to? And it used to be Tony Benn, William Hague, people would go in, David Blunkett. I think people will go into the Commons to listen to George speak.
So George Galloway made, I think, probably one of the best speeches I've ever heard in the House of Commons.
This war in which he glories, although how I wish he'd put on a tin hat and pick up a gun and go and fight himself, how I wish to see that sight. This war in which he glories has cost the lives, according to those well-known Saddamist fronts, the Lancet and Johns Hopkins University, well in excess of 100,000 people's lives. And hundreds of thousands more have been maimed and wounded. And it was all for a pack of lies. There were no weapons of mass destruction.
Senator, this is the mother of all smoke screens. You are trying to divert attention from the crimes that you supported, from the theft of billions of dollars of Iraq's wealth. Have a look at the real oil for food scandal. Have a look at the 14 months you were in charge of Baghdad, the first 14 months, when $8.8 billion of Iraq's wealth went missing on your watch. Have a look at Halliburton and the other American corporations that stole not only Iraq's money, but the money of the American taxpayer. Have a look at the oil that you didn't even meter, that you were shipping out of the country and selling, the proceeds of which went who knows where. Have a look at the $800 million you gave to American military commanders to hand out around the country without even counting it or weighing it. Have a look at the real scandal breaking in the newspapers today, revealed in the earlier testimony in this committee, that the biggest sanctions busters were not me or Russian politicians or French politicians. The real sanctions busters were your own companies with the connivance of your own government.
Can I ask you about a report that's in today's Sunday Telegraph, which showed that Iran has given Hezbollah long-range missiles capable of targeting any part of Israel? Iran, according to this Iranian MP who helped found Hezbollah, has also said that Iran has given the organization authorization to target Tel Aviv. Can you blame Israel for wanting to destroy those missiles?
But this is preposterous. America has given Israel missiles that can target not just every city in Lebanon, but every city in the Arab and Muslim world, including Iran. Why should America be allowed to give long-range missiles to Israel, including hundreds of nuclear missiles? But Iran
because it's
is not
given it to a
to
terrorist organization.
But they're not a terrorist organization. Only in the mind of Rupert Murdoch's Sky and the Times and the Sun and
on.
The News of the World.
I'm going to stop
not
you
a
there,
terrorist
Mr. Galloway.
Organization.
Prescribed
it's
terrorist
that
organizations.
Is the terrorist
One man's terrorist.
State.
is another man's freedom fighter. We know that perfectly well. In most people's eyes, they are deemed to be...
No, they
had a choice, didn't they? Let's understand this. They had a choice, like the IRA,
to take on politics. Listen, Anna.
I'm saying they had a choice
to
absorb the idea of politics. They've got two Hezbollah cabinet ministers.
Anna, one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. You are totally wrong in saying that in most people's eyes, Hezbollah are terrorists. In most people's eyes, Israel is a terrorist state. It's the fact that you cannot comprehend that fact that leads to the bias which runs through all of your reporting and every question that you've asked me in this interview. There was no link between Iraq and Al-Qaeda. There was no link between Iraq and the atrocities on the 9th of September, on the 9/11 here in the United States. There was no welcome for the foreign armies that invaded Iraq. Hitchens said they would be greeted by flowers, but there are 2,000 young American boys lying in the ground now, testimony to the fact that they were welcomed by something else. And thousands more wounded, maimed, many of them in wheelchairs for the rest of their lives, testament to the folly of Hitchens and Bush and Cheney and the rest of the neocon gang that dragged your country into this disaster.
Because Brown said it, all the money in the world to pay for the war. He said, whatever it takes, I'll write the check. He was at that time trying to show how much like Mr. Blair he was. It may be that in the next few months he'll spend a lot of time trying to show us how different from Mr. Blair he really is. For me, if you'll forgive me putting it bluntly, they're two cheeks of the same arse. Gordon Brown wrote the cheque and he was very clear about it. Whatever it takes, I'll write the cheque. So we have money to go around the world setting fire to other people's countries. But we don't have money to keep our old age pensioners warm in winter.
He's trotting out the same ghastly tropes. He's still treating the Palestinian people with utter contempt by using their bones to build a pulpit for himself to spew this divisive rubbish that he always does. But I was on television with him years ago, and the first thing he said, Blair and Brown, he says their two cheeks are the same up. You know, he's a slightly different word, not backside. Mm. He used that against me and somebody else. He just uses it over and over.
Keir Starmer and Rishi Sunak are two cheeks of the same backside, and they both got well and truly spanked tonight here in Rochdale.
And him, and when you speak to figures, they said, well, we didn't want to have a situation where George Galloway won. And now George Galloway is going to be entering the House of Commons. He's going to be a vocal MP, I think we can safely assume.
George Galloway has won on his anti-Semitic ticket.
I'm fond of a quote from Ho Chi Minh. Calamity has hardened me and turned my mind to steel.
On the other hand, so are other demagogues in history. They have that skill and that ability. Mm. All we can say is the one saving grace is if he has one, and the indications are not good for democracy, they're good for Galloway. Mm. The indications are that he will only be an MP for a short time and he will be a pariah in that.
They said all these things about me in the by-election. And in the by-election, it was them that got crushed in the democratic process. So I'm not sure why he would reheat it. Now,
the Prime Minister is saying
that
you are... We're talking
as if this is God. We're talking about little Rishi Sunak in the fag end of his prime ministership. Don't talk to me as if he's come down from the mount with tablets of stone. The things that he says are somehow meant to awe me. They may awe you, they don't awe me.
A lot of people have just watched what the Prime Minister said. This is your opportunity to respond to what he said.
Well,
he says that there are forces here at home trying to tear us apart. He is implying you are a divisive figure.
Well,
you have run an election campaign that has tried to appeal, particularly, not
won?
Entirely,
who
to
won?
One section of the community.
Who won the election? Me or Rishi Sunak? I've got the Democratic mandate here, not Rishi Sunak. He didn't even come second. He was lucky to come third. So don't put to me statements made by Rishi Sunak as if I'm supposed to be impressed by them.
We
don't impress me much.
We at Sky have spent some time today on the streets of Rochdale, and there are people who say that they feel intimidated by people like you and the people that have supported you.
And they have pointed out
that you have concentrated your campaign on foreign affairs, and they worry that Rochdale will not be the winner.
That's my answer to you. I was just elected with a thumping majority by the electorate in Rochdale.
Had powerful enemies, but now I have the most powerful enemies of all. I have the United States Republican neocon leadership after me. I have Tony Blair after me. If John Howard had ever heard of me, he'd be after me too. The Iraqi puppet regime are after me. The state of Israel has long regarded me as an enemy. I have very powerful enemies with many resources.
He has given one person a job opportunity, George Galloway.
More than 15 years ago, in Parliament, on the record, I made clear my detestation of the Iraqi dictatorship. I just don't believe in murdering people's children because you don't like their dictator.
If people are not held to account for, at the very minimum, the mistakes that they've made, at the very worst, the crimes that they've committed, then why would anyone avoid those crimes or mistakes in the future? If you can, with impunity, set the world on fire and go on to make £100 million, which Tony Blair has done, why would others not go down that path too?
I've met Saddam Hussein exactly the same number of times as Donald Rumsfeld met him. The difference is, Donald Rumsfeld met him to sell him guns and to give him maps the better to target those guns. I met him to try and bring about an end to sanctions, suffering, and war. And on the second of the two occasions, I met him to try and persuade him to allow Dr. Hans Blix and the United Nations weapons inspectors back into the country. A rather better use of two meetings with Saddam Hussein than your own Secretary of State for Defense made of his.
The media is deeply complicit in all of these crimes. It completely failed in its duty to hold leaders to account, to test their arguments. It became an echo chamber for Blair. And all the lies they told, they have never atoned for. And in fact, they've continued to repeat them in one conflict after another in this whole miserable affair.
I opposed this program with all my heart. Not because Saddam was getting kickbacks from it, and I don't know when it's alleged these kickbacks started. Not because some individuals were getting rich doing business with Iraq under it, but because it was a murderous policy of killing huge numbers of Iraqis. That's what troubles me. That's what troubles me.
Something which is a crime and a blunder, which has achieved the opposite of the effect that it was supposed to, which has made thousands of new bin Ladens, in fact, tens of thousands of new bin Ladens. You've got 1.5 billion Muslims out there boiling with anger at us. Made the whole world a much more dangerous place, left your own country not trusting a word you say. I mean, the reason Blair is going, because nobody believes him any longer, just the idiots in the bubble at the Labour Party conference. The rest of the country no longer believes
Eamon
the word
Delaney
you say.
Is in the audience at the other McGill. You would take issue with George.
I would. I just think it'd be wonderful to have as simple a view of the world as George has. I mean, if these men are evil men and are war criminals, what does that mean that Saddam Hussein is? This is a man who invaded two neighboring countries, a force for instability for 10 to 15 years, massacred hundreds of thousands of civilians, not deaths which happened through matters of war or airstrikes. You know, Blair didn't willingly go out and cite, I think I'll gas the Kurds, I think I'll gas the people of Birmingham, or I'll kill hundreds of thousands of Shiite Muslims in the south, as Saddam did. This is a man who George used to go over and cozy up to and thought he could find reasonable. Perhaps that was the two cheeks of the same arse there that you were kissing at the time. And you've made a career of it. I admire your principles, and I know you're motivated and so on, but I think your view is utterly wrong-headed, and the fluency with which you deliver it, I think, is really damaging, because it means that throughout the world, where we have people like Saddam or Hitler or Mugabe or the situation in Myanmar, we can't intervene, because you'll come along and say immediately that those democratic countries doing so with or without a UN mandate are war criminals.
Where'd you get that, agent?
He's the editor McGill. He's a respected journalist in this town.
What a chance to charge then, George? To make a career out of it.
I don't even know who you are, so you're not anybody to charge me.
Does it matter who I am? I'm not a celebrity.
It does matter. No, it does matter.
I'm not a celebrity like you are.
It does matter. It does matter now that I know you're the editor of McGill. It's absolutely shocking that an editor is so ignorant and ill-informed about these great issues. First of all, he's got all his numbers wrong. We've killed far more Iraqis than Saddam Hussein ever did. Secondly, I'm dealing with Saddam Hussein. When Britain and America were arming Saddam Hussein, I was outside his embassy demonstrating for human rights and for justice in Iraq and being denounced by the British and American governments and the big newspapers for causing trouble, because Saddam was a bosom buddy of Britain and America. You want to talk about gassing the Kurds? Who sold them the gas?
I know,
it wasn't me.
You want to start the clock when you want to start.
Well,
you could go back and back forever. They armed Iraq to match Iran. Move to 1990 when Saddam invaded Kuwait.
No, why do you want to start the story at 1990?
Well, we go to 1945.
Go to 1945. Go to 1988.
Tell us about
1988,
Saddam.
Just 2 years before the date you want to start on, the bombing of the Kurds in Halabja was done with weapons given to Saddam by Britain and America and West Germany.
Now, it was done by Saddam.
Yes, but he was able to do it because of weapons that we gave him, because of the immoral principle that was in vogue at the time, that my enemy's enemy is my friend. The very principle which brought us Osama bin Laden. Bin Laden was equally armed and supported by Britain and America because we thought that you could have a tiger by the tail. We now know differently.
Guns and weapons are sold throughout the world. They end up in the wrong hands.
They ended up in the hands they were intended to.
What was your solution?
Bin Laden.
You're against sanctions.
Bin Laden. I'm speaking through the chair because that's what I'm used to doing. Yeah. We're going to have a harangue. I wasn't expecting this, but you're welcome to have a stairhead. You're welcome to have a stairhead brawl with me if you like.
I mean, you two are never going to agree, that's for sure.
Well, I don't know who he is, so I don't know if we're ever going to agree. You'll forgive me.
Can I ask you another question, George? Did you say that the assassination of Tony Blair could be morally justified?
I said if you were an Iraqi whose home had been destroyed, whose country had been broken into 1,000 pieces, whose sons were in Abu Ghraib prison being tortured, whose house had been demolished, whose job had been disappeared and privatized, and whose street was occupied by foreign soldiers, I've no doubt you could make a good moral case for the assassination of Tony
Blair. If you found out of a plot that would do for Tony Blair, what would you do about it?
I would tell him.
You would save his life.
I would tell him, and I'd say, do you remember that conversation we had outside the gentleman's lavatory? You should have listened to me, and hundreds of thousands of people that are dead now would still be alive. The world would not be destabilized, and the only man in Ireland, the editor of McGill, would be the only man in the country who thinks you and Bush did a good job. And I think that if I got that chance to speak to Tony Blair, to warn him of that plot, it would be for this reason, that the assassination of Blair would merely strengthen the hand of people like him who want to go around the world invading other people's countries, setting up regimes that are more to their liking, because they see the world as a kind of white man's burden, that somebody, God perhaps, gave us a job of setting to rights in our own image. I find that attitude disgusting, and most disgusting in Ireland, a country that was occupied by colonialism for hundreds of years. You've got people justifying colonialism now calling themselves editors of Radical Magazine.
You killed a million people in Iraq. It's incredible that you have the brass neck to be sitting here now urging another Iraq war.
George, if I were still in Parliament, I would be there tomorrow living up to my responsibility to answer the call of the Iraqi government and people to help to support them. And the fact that you aren't is something that you will have to live with.
Let me ask a final question to you, George.
if not bombing, if not intervention, how do we deal with this cancer?
Give Iraq the weapons that it's already paid for but haven't been delivered. Strengthen the Peshmerga, strengthen the governments of Iraq and Syria, and ask Saudi Arabia, Turkey and Iran to fight this battle. It's their battle, not ours.
We have now had an election where two of the candidates have alleged intimidation. The Prime Minister referenced that intimidation in his address
you
on the steps of...
to the Prime Minister as if that's supposed to impress me. The Prime Minister is... The Prime Minister is a rather diminutive, diminished and degraded politician. He made a party political statement. I don't care about Rishi Sunak's attitude. What I care about is that the returning officer, a man of unimpeachable integrity, I'm sure you'll agree, declared it a free and fair election and me as the winner, and Rishi Sunak as one of the crushed two big parties in the state.
So yeah. why are two candidates...
Are you going to keep repeating the same questions to me? Because I have other people to talk to. So let's make this the last one, shall we?
We got a party to go with.
Allegations of intimidation, allegations that your supporters intimidated
That's
other candidates.
Five what times you you've said that. The returning officer declared it last night. You were there as a free and fair election and me as the winner.
And the Electoral Commission and the Electoral Commission today have said that they're going to look and talk to the parties.
You have to just suck it up. I won the election. Yeah. Yeah.
George Galloway, thank you very much indeed.
I put it this way. This is not the Holocaust. 1,000 people is horrific, but it is not the Holocaust. The Holocaust involved millions upon millions of people, perhaps 10 million or more, well over half of them Jews, systematically, industrially, building factories in order to annihilate people, and with a clear and defined genocidal purpose. This is not the Holocaust. And Israel are not the Nazis, but they are behaving like Nazis. In this current conflict, the dark heart of Zionism and its ideology and practice has been exposed. And I said during Cast Lead, and I'm saying it again now, and the furore about it during Cast Lead was great, the furore about it now is not, because it's kind of obvious. This may not be, and is not, the Holocaust, but it is the Warsaw Ghetto. In fact, it's the Warsaw Ghetto in almost every particular. The Nazis built a ghetto in Warsaw, surrounded it by barbed wire and guards with dogs, and allowed the people inside to waste away and starve, and to will the contraction of fatal disease which began one by one to wipe out the Jews entrapped in the Warsaw Ghetto. Deciding that they would rather die on their feet than die one by one on their knees or their bed, or wait for their captor to come along and put them on a train to a gas chamber and kill them, the Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto rose up and wrote their name in the stars. The Nazis called them terrorists. They actually used that word. Everybody else regarded them as heroes, as freedom fighters. I maintain that the situation in Gaza is exactly comparable to the situation of the Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto. I believe that that is a fair comparison. The situation in Gaza has gotten far worse since I was last there, as you may know. During Cast Lead, some of you may even have been with me, I led first one and then several siege-breaking convoys which entered Gaza and broke the siege, bringing material aid, but more importantly, raising the banner of Palestine all the way through the countries that we traveled and lifting the spirits of the people entrapped in Gaza. So their attitude to human rights in other countries should be viewed through the prism of poor Julian Assange, a truth teller, a whistleblower, a publisher, and a journalist.
who has now languished for years behind bars now in a maximum security prison in the capital of the United Kingdom, which professes to be a champion of human rights and which lectures other countries on their shortcomings or failures in the field of human rights. Thirdly, the Western countries have no problem at all firmly allying themselves with countries that care nothing at all about human rights, not even pay lip service to the question of human rights, who murder their journalists, who banish any person who speaks out against the prevailing current, who crack down, make impossible any dissident view, even when those dissident views happen to be right and happen to be calling out the extent to which the country that they live in is sailing in entirely the wrong direction, fast towards the rocks. I don't need to name those countries, but you all know which kind of countries I'm referring to, who receive endless subventions of weaponry, of money, of political and diplomatic support, of propagandistic support, even though the very last thing in the world they are is a democratic and free society. So the so-called free society, always lecturing others on human rights, are highly selective about the countries that they are lecturing. Which leads me to my conclusion, long ago reached, that the Western imperial countries care next to nothing about human rights, even in their own countries. They wear it as lipstick on a pig, but it's still a pig when you wipe the lipstick off. They wear it or brandish it as a weapon with which to isolate, traduce, ostracize, and if necessary, militarize their own countries and their own societies against the people that they are beating with the stick marked human rights.
When you are told that the resistance in Gaza is hiding behind the civilian population, is using the civilian population as human shields, when you're told, why are the weapons so close to the people in Gaza? Gaza is 25 miles long and 4.5 miles wide. It is one of the most densely populated places on the earth. There is no open space in Gaza. There are no mountains. There is no jungle. There is no place where the resistance could go, even if it were wise for them to do so. The resistance are the people. It's not an army. The Palestinians don't have an army. They have fighters who are living in this hellhole and bearing arms for the day, which comes often enough, when their hellhole is invaded, their families massacred. That little that they have is destroyed all around them. They say, why are there rockets amongst the population? The question is not why there are rockets amongst the population. Everything and everybody is amongst the population. The question is, why are there rockets?
I want to talk about the role of NGOs. I was in the audience when Fidel Castro in Cuba, more than 30 years ago, described NGOs, especially those active in the field of so-called human rights, as a Trojan horse sent through the gates by their Western benefactors, only to disgorge their army of subverters, destabilizers, purveyors of color revolutions as soon as the time is right. Castro banned these NGOs from Cuba. And every country should at the very least beware of non-government organizations, because increasingly they are very definitely GOs. They are government organizations. They are AGOs. They are anti-government organizations in your country, serving the interests of the country that sent them, that funds them, that provides the overarching narrative for them, and which gives them their marching orders. Beware of the Greeks bearing gifts is a well-known saw in the English language. It was the Greeks that sent the Trojan horse through the gate, apparently as a gift, apparently as a benefaction, but with the gravest of ill intentions. My advice to everyone watching and listening to this is not to believe that the governments of the West or their arms in the NGOs are genuinely concerned for your people, your peoples. Their purpose is to serve the interests of the already rich and powerful, the hegemonic forces who fear they are losing daily their once overwhelming power in the world.
We wanted peace, we got war, we mustn't make the same mistake again. I'm sorry, Mr. Galloway?
You said we, are you an Israeli?
I am, yes.
I don't debate with Israelis, I've been misled. Sorry.
What? Racism?
Racism? I don't recognise Israel and I don't debate with Israelis.
ערב טוב מר גלוי, אני ישראלי, יש לי אזרחות ישראלי. ישראלית, יש לי דרכון ישראלי. כל המשפחה שלי גרים בארץ, ואתה לא אוהב לדבר עם ישראלים. אתה לא רוצה לדבר עם ישראלים. לא עם ישראלים מהממשלה, אבל עם כל הישראלים. Mr. Galloway.
Don't come any closer to me. Because I'm feeling threatened by you. Don't come any closer to me. What's that up your jumper?
This is an Israeli flag. I'm an Israeli, Mr. Galloway. And you speak with fascists in Beirut. You interview Mr. Mahmadinejad for Press TV.
You're doing yourself a lot of harm here, son.
Yeah. I think you did a lot of harm by not speaking to my friend Elon and having a constructive dialogue with him. And sir, I don't have a question for you, as you can see, because I don't debate with racists. Thank you, sir.
Well, it's funny, the last time I saw that flag was on Saturday. And you can consult innumerable sources on the internet about this. The last time I saw that flag was on Saturday in Bradford, held aloft by the English Defence League. It's there, published in many newspapers, broadcast on many news bulletins, and I think that it's come to something that England's fascist formation finds the flag of Israel the most appropriate flag to fly.
I said in a debate that I would not debate with a Pakistani, I would rightly be called a racist. My question for you is, are you a racist?
Why are you applauding that? What kind of people would applaud that? Am I a racist? You've sat through the last hour and a half of me speaking, and you're applauding someone asking me if I'm a racist? What kind of people are you? Or do you just applaud anything? Would you just applaud anything? You made a better job of it than your friend. I'll grant you that. Talking to me in a language I don't understand and then waving an Israeli flag in my face was not, I suspect, the finest moment that he will experience in what I hope is a long life in public affairs. I'll let you in on something you don't know. I'm one of the few people on the left in Britain who traveled the length and breadth of apartheid South Africa as an underground agent of the African National Congress led by Nelson Mandela then, in Paulsmoor Prison in Cape Town. Therefore, the subject of apartheid
is particularly important to me. The question of racism is particularly important to me. And in parenthesis, let me tell you this, that throughout the entirety of my time underground in South Africa under apartheid, every house I slept in, every dinner I ate, every car I drove in was provided by Jewish activists of the African National Congress. So Jews don't have to be on the side of apartheid. They don't have to be on the side of racism. Jewish heroes amongst my blood brotherhood, like Dennis Goldberg, who served 27 years on Robben Island in Paulsmoor prison, but who never was able to touch Mandela and his comrades because they were on one side of the apartheid prison wall, and he and a few other Jewish heroes of the African National Congress were on the other. Dennis Goldberg, Albie Sachs, Joe Slovo, Ruth First. Perhaps you've heard of these people. If you haven't, look them up. Jews don't have to be on the side of apartheid. They can stand up against it. And I say to those who imagine that they are friends of the state whose flag was just waved in my face, turn away from the racist apartheid ideology of Zionism. Turn back to where Jews were before the emergence and the hegemony of Zionism. The greatest people on the earth were Jews. The leaders of the socialist, communist, trade union, liberal, enlightenment, throughout the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries were great Jews. Marx himself was a Jew. None of them believed that as Jews, they should go and take somebody else's country and drive millions of them around the world as refugees. All of them would have turned their back against such an ideology. But because of my experience out in South Africa, which included, by the way, being battered and bloodied by a Scottish South African policeman called Campbell, one of the reasons why I hate Alistair Campbell so much, in Guguletu police station, in the Guguletu township in Cape Town, although the policeman had eventually to wash my feet in public, in penitence. But that's another story. Because of my time in South Africa, because of the decades that I worked against apartheid in South Africa, do you imagine that I would turn up at a university and debate apartheid with a supporter from South Africa of the apartheid system? I'd rather punch him in the face than debate with him. Why? Because apartheid is a racist poison. It is the worst kind of fascism. And I would never debate with any supporter of South African apartheid. Why should I debate with a supporter of Israeli apartheid?
Your hope for a binational state called Israel-Palestine. How is this possible when Hamas throw their opposition, Fatah, off the roof, and Mahmoud Abbas siphons off aid for his own resources, such as houses, and denies the right of the Jews, the historical rights of the Jews to the Western Wall?
Is this really Oxford? Mahmoud Abbas denies the right of the Jews to pray at the Western Wall? What are you talking about, man? Mahmoud Abbas is an American stooge. Why would he deny the right of Jews to pray at the Western Wall? Where did you get that from? What cesspit of false propaganda did you dredge that allegation from. It's totally absurd. There is no Palestinian, none, not Hamas or anybody else, who denies Jews the right to pray at the Western Wall. I don't know if Hamas threw opposition Fatah people off roofs. If they did, then no one will condemn it more than me as a lifelong supporter of Fatah. I have supported Fatah and President Arafat, God rest his soul, all of my life. You seem not to know that. You seem to imagine that I'm here to defend Hamas. I don't even like Hamas. I would never have voted for Hamas. I hope they get voted out at the next Palestinian election. Where do you get this stuff from? The point is that the Palestinian people are the people whose country has disappeared. And it's now called Israel. The Palestinian people are the people living outside in the refugee camps with a right to go back. That's all. Now, my solution is a democratic one. Everyone who's entitled to live there must be allowed to live there. And they must be allowed to live there as equal citizens. One man, one woman, one vote. What conceivably could be wrong with that? You wouldn't wish anything else for anywhere else. So why would you wish it for Palestine to be otherwise? Look, you can go on supporting Israel if you like. You can go on blaming the Palestinians as terrorists if you like, even though they are the victims of the terrorists. But all you'll be doing, I warn you, and you're a young man with more at stake than me, all you'll be doing is continuing to fill the swamp with bitterness and hatred. And a terrible harvest can only come from that.
And 4 out of 5 people in the country want an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. That will have a political expression if it can, and in one sense, George is that expression.
OK, well, we'll let you go, but before we go, do you want to say a quick word of congratulations to George Galloway this morning?
I think we'll leave it there.
From Sven-Göran Eriksson to the Countess of Wessex, a series of celebrities have been duped by a journalist who disguises himself in Arab robes. His newspaper, The News of the World, also says his work has put many criminals behind bars. Now, Mazhar Mahmood's identity could itself be exposed after a legal victory by George Galloway.
In gorgeous George Galloway, man with no face, but his disguise is all too familiar. The fake sheikh, News of the World undercover reporter Mazhar Mahmood. But could he have met his match? An MP who recently described himself as a bit of a catch.
I think it was always going to happen that one day somebody, after all these other people got done by the fake sheikh, that somebody would recognise him. And it's just rather sweet that it is George Galloway, because George Galloway is the sort of person who's going to make a lot of hay about it, and indeed has done.
But his style of journalism courts criticism. He's often accused of entrapment. His greatest scoop was exposing an alleged plot to kidnap Victoria Beckham. 5 men were arrested, but the case fell apart after it was revealed that the main witness had been paid by Mahmood's newspaper. Could the reporter be losing his touch? When he invited George Galloway to a business meeting at the Dorchester Hotel on Park Lane, the MP, who once dressed up as a cat on a reality TV show, immediately smelt a rat. When Mr. Galloway arrived here for his dinner date, he was met by a man wearing Arab costume who claimed to be an Islamist. Yet he didn't have a beard or seem to know much about Islamic practices. The fake sheikh then started to ask Mr. Galloway a number of crude questions about how to fund an MP. The media-savvy Mr. Galloway lodged a complaint with the Speaker of the House of Commons and the Met Police, claiming Mahmood tried to get him to make anti-Semitic remarks.
This man's not a journalist, he's a provocateur. He sets people up. Some of these criminals that Mr. Ferrari is booming about were actually entrapped in the crimes that they committed
by this man. In 1999, I spoke about this in Parliament.
But I mean, there are two issues here. One is the idea of a newspaper going to law anyway against yes. other journalists. But the important part of that is that they used laws that they have themselves tried to overturn. In other words, for example, they wanted the identity of the Bulger murderers known, and they've wanted Mary Bell to be identified.
Yes.
Now they say, oh, no, no, because they're protected, we should be protected.
Both of those public services, I would say. And we have to realise what Mazhir Mahmood has done. He is not a criminal. He's, to my knowledge, committed no criminal acts, unless Mr. Galloway can tell otherwise. What's happened is, unfortunately...
Well, what is in fact, what he did, which was to try to goad him into making anti-Semitic statements?
John, you're right. It was a clumsy one. They shouldn't have done it. Well, but I don't think it's right. I don't think it's right that Mazhir Mahmood should be remembered for that. It would be the same as, say, remembering somebody who appeared on a television programme because he dressed in a lurid pink leotard and tried to drink milk out of an actress's hands. Well, I'm sure Mr. Galloway wouldn't want to be remembered solely for that.
You'd have cut even less of a dash in a lurid pink leotard than
me. Absolutely. If you want to make it personal, we can.
If I want to make it personal. Listen, he will be remembered for this and for other disreputable attempts to entrap people into behaviour that they would not otherwise
have... They committed crimes, Mr. Galloway.
Well, I certainly have committed no crimes. But he asked me to. He suggested that he could foreign fund the Respect Party covertly through English people. When I told him this was completely illegal, and rightly so, he pressed the point and pressed the point, all the while speaking into a microphone. That's why I've demanded that they publish the text of the conversation. When that failed, he began Holocaust denying, trying to lead me down a road of making anti-Semitic remarks. When that failed, he must have found the bill when it arrived quite a painful one. The Dorchester is not cheap. Now I bring you the dread news that David Ward, my parliamentary colleague from Bradford East, has, after a day of rough treatment, no doubt, categorically apologised for the tweet that he made yesterday. I'm very sorry that he categorically apologised for it. And as I said last night, the synthetic rage of New Labour about what he said, which was, you don't know it, if I was living in Gaza, I'd be tempted to fire rockets too, is identical, almost word for word, to what Cherie Blair said almost a decade ago. Cherie Blair and the Queen of Jordan, having heard the miserable stories that they heard, opined that the wonder is not that some of these people become suicide bombers, the wonder is that more of them don't become suicide bombers. That's actually a stronger statement than David Ward has now been prevailed upon to categorically apologize for. And both Cherie Blair and David Ward were merely speaking the obvious truth. After all, if you were living in Gaza under siege, if your children had been killed, might be killed, if your hovel had been, might be, destroyed at any moment, and you could see through the wire the very land which was yours and from which you were driven, because there's another 80% in this story, 80% of the people of Gaza are refugees. They were never born in Gaza. They were driven to Gaza as refugees and are now imprisoned within it. And they can't see many of them. They can't see the village that they left because that's been destroyed and new cities built on top of it. But they can see the land, that which was once theirs and their parents. What would you do if it was you? Would you take up arms against this sea of troubles and try, by opposing, to end them? Or would you what? Walk into the sea and commit suicide? If you did, you'd be shot before you got past shoulder deep. Would you simply lie down fatalistically and accept 65 years of this? Or would you fight? Well, some of you may be pacifists, I myself am not. And unlike David Ward, I wouldn't just fire rockets, I'd fight them with my bare hands if I could get my hands on the people responsible for these crimes. Write that down.
somebody will call on me to apologize tomorrow. The one thing you can be sure of, I'll not be apologizing, categorically or otherwise, at Forum. No, I'm fasting. The